Okay. Okay, good morning, Elkview Baptist Church. Good morning. October 23rd, beautiful month, October. We've got some kind of celebration today to kick off our service this morning, and missionary here from, it's been over in Zimbabwe quite a bit, and new director of IMB, so we'll meet Jamie a little later, but let's see, were you going to throw up a slide there? We'll start with the celebration. A couple things, Bill. We prayed 3 or 4 months ago about a new bus, and it came in this week, and the seniors were able to take a trip to the Amish country, had the maiden voyage. How'd it work out, Jerry? All right. Said 14 young seniors take a beautiful trip to the Amish country safely back this weekend, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, so that's great. I understand they had plenty of room for luggage, seating, everything. So, of course, this is a 15-passenger bus, and Jerry was the driver on this trip, so thank you, Lord. We praise him for that. Next, I've got the trustees, and just this is just an example how the trustees work together to what's in the best interest of the church and what can we do for the church. And they, you know, facilitated, John Parker and others just facilitated getting this bus here. So thank you to the trustees. And yesterday they had a work party. I think there's nine people here, and a lot of things were accomplished, a lot of things that needed to be done and cleaned up, tidied up, and some maintenance. And so it's just a real good day yesterday with the work party. Another thing I want to mention, just as a celebration, we have a lady, she was here last week, that's helping us with our social media, and she's been working on Facebook, so we now have two Facebook pages, clearly, I think, distinct and clarified now that one of them's a regular Elkview Baptist Church Facebook page, which we want to encourage people to use, and the other one's Elkview Baptist Church Private. So it's just what you would expect. It's private for prayer requests and things, more private, because only the members of the church see that. The Elkview Baptist Church, everybody can see that. Whoever's, you know, wants to go on a website and see Elkview Baptist Church, they can see that. So so my encouragement is for people to use Facebook more. Use it for things about things going on at the church. It's a quick, easy way to do that. And one of the things we're doing, the team is doing, is they're putting a spotlight on a couple, or a spotlight on somebody that's doing great work here at Elkview. And you saw the first ones was Jerry and Kip and all the things they do with the seniors. So there'll be other ones. It's just a way to recognize what goes on, what the things people do, and it's just a praise that God puts these people here to do things, and it spreads that and lets others see it. I mean, I get to see it kind of being involved in the church, and it's good that everybody gets to see those kind of things. So there'll be more of those. So now the last thing I've got for as far as appreciation goes, October is what? October is Pastor Appreciation Month. So I'm going to ask, is Josh down here, Pastor Charles and Pastor Cliff, if y'all will come up. And Pastor Josh is here. Katie, you can come up too if you want. I know you're right there with Josh all the time. Oh, that was the other celebration too. We had an adult clue night last night. We had 11 teens that were here. And how'd the game go, Josh?
It went well.
Okay, I don't know if anybody's ever played adult clue. I have not, but have you, Josh, ever played adult clue before?
Not in person. That was our first time.
Okay, all right. So things have really picked up. I think our church, to me, prayed about Awanas, prayed about getting, you know, things started back up, and that's happened, and more youth are coming in, so it's really a good thing. So anyway, we are fortunate to have three pastors, and the good thing is, and this kind of shows me how God works, they complement each other. They all have their strengths and, you know, different parts of the ministry, and they all complement each other. So we've got Pastor Charles with all of his experience, and he just pulls it together like glue, and he's just so focused on everything and always looking ahead. you know, he mentions things to me, and he's always thinking ahead, and we're so fortunate to have somebody with this kind of vision and planning things ahead. We've got Pastor Cliff that's been there and done that. 55 years, Cliff? 55 years in ministry? You forget, okay. Approximately 55, at least 55 years, and his counterpart, Ruth Ann's not here today, but she's a part of that ministry as well. So we are very, very, very appreciative, very fortunate to have Pastor Cliff and all of his experience and him showering everyone with their love and encouragement. Love and encouragement. What could God ask us to do more than love, encourage others? And if you're not sure about how to do it, just watch Cliff any given day. And then we've got Pastor Josh that came in. Two years Josh has been here now. Probably didn't know what to expect in an actual job, even though his dad was a pastor. But I get to see what Josh gets to do, and I always say he should be paying us because he gets to do so many things in this church. You get to do so many things. You're learning so much, Josh. And it's just, hey, Josh, can you help? Do you think about this? Can you do this? And it's just, you see him on Sunday morning, he's almost spinning. But he does it really well. The youth's coming together. He's got a lot of leaders now. He's forming that teams, those teams of the leaders. So great job, Josh. So we do have something for our pastors. Gift from the church. Thank you, Pastor Cliff. Thank you, Pastor Josh and Katie. And thank you, Pastor Charles. So we will we'll have a prayer and also kick off our service. One of the things I want to read is just looking at something, thinking about these three gentlemen, these three servants, is from New King James, Isaiah 52:7. Isaiah 52:7. How beautiful upon the mountains, makes me think of West Virginia, how beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of him who brings good news, who proclaims peace, who brings glad tidings of good things, who proclaims salvation. That's what it's all about, leading others to salvation. Who says to Zion, your God reigns, your God reigns, and he'll reign eternally. So with that, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you at this time, and it's just amazing how you've brought three different pastors together at this church, all within the last 4 years or so, and they've come together in harmony. And it's just a beautiful sight to see how they all work together, how they complement each other, how their wives are involved to help encourage them too, both internally and externally here at the church. We thank you for this combination of pastors. We ask that you give Pastor Charles, continue to give him that vision, that passion to do what's best for this church and his long-range goals, and just feeding us, leading us, guiding us. We ask you to continue. We thank you for Pastor Cliff and his love and encouragement. We just ask that you continue to give him the health for him and Ruth Ann to be able to do that, just to just witness right in front of us every week how we should love and encourage others. And we thank you for that and the wisdom he brings. If you have a question about something you read in the Bible, call Pastor Cliff and he'll explain it to you in a way that you'll be glad you did. And for Pastor Josh, young Pastor Josh, who's just coming in and seeing everything, helping in all areas. He preached a couple weeks ago, and he's just doing whatever needs to be done here, but focused on the youth. And we just thank you for strengthening our youth at this time. And we thank you for Pastor Josh. Continue to give him the wisdom and the strength and the energy to lead the youth. Now, Father, we just ask that you be with the service today, be with our missionary Jamie Smith, and be with all the singing and everything else, to be a harmonious service today, honoring you. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Okay.
changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words impart. We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words impart. We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words
Amen. So thankful for the Word of God. It's our guide. It's the way the Lord speaks to us each day. It's such a treasure. Would you stand with us this morning as we worship together through music?
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise. Sing praise. With a mighty hand and outstretched arm, His love endures forever, for the light
bow your heads with me, please. Our Father, as we cast our mind to Calvary this morning, we are reminded of your kindness and love expressed toward us, the generosity of your Spirit poured out within us, not because of who we are, but because of your redeeming grace, the mercy of the gospel, the work of Christ on the cross, that he went through the cross, through the grave, and emptied that tomb. We cast our mind toward our Savior because we have been elevated to live in high places. And it's your amazing grace flowing in us today that makes us a new creature. And we call upon you for life-changing power. Oh, we look for your return. And we do grieve with so much heaviness of heart and so much sin that is all around us. But Lord, for the days we have left, would you anchor us to our beautiful Savior and the power of the risen Christ, that we might make a difference in your kingdom? You know, it's your grace that's available to us. We don't want to miss it because it's amazing and it's life-changing. So continue your good work in the remainder of this service. In Jesus' sweet and holy name, amen. You may be seated.
Oh, praise God for his wonderful word. So thankful for the grace of God. And whenever I think about God's grace and his mercy, I think of this song. And the title of it is called, Were It Not for Grace. And I've reflected so many times on where I would be this morning, and it scares me. Had it not been for the grace of God and his tender mercies before I came to know Jesus Christ as my personal Savior, there was many opportunities in my life, bad opportunities, that I could be in the middle of hell this morning were it not for God's grace. And I am so thankful for that. And I thank God for this church and the love that the Holy Spirit brings in our congregation and into our hearts. So I pray that this song will just be a blessing to you this morning. Were it not for grace. Measured out my days, life carried me along. In my heart I longed to follow God, but knew I'd never be so strong. Hard at this world to see where heaven could be gained, just to find where to begin, where human efforts are all in vain. Were it not for grace, salvation up to me, and I know how that would go, and the battles I would face, so ever running but losing the race, were So here is all my praise, expressed with all my heart, offered to a friend who took my place. Saw in full just how much his love would cost. He still went that final mile between me and heaven so I would not be lost. Were it not for grace,
missionary speaker today. His name is Jamie Smith. When we first met Jamie and Mandy and three, they had three little blonde-headed children just stair-stepped, and I still remember the day we took them on for support in the lobby out there. They presented so beautifully as a family, and one thing I thought to myself is they're taking those three beautiful babies to Zambia, Africa. A less than hospitable environment. And let me just say a little, they went straight to village ministry as they got into Zambia, hands-on. If you can imagine living in some of the most simple, primitive conditions and ministering in that context. And, you know, Paul said that as he was a missionary, he was in perils often, in journeys often. And he lists eight specific types of perils. And you ought to hear some of the stories from the Smith family. I remember a prayer letter years ago that said, would you help us? We found that as we go to the really remote spots out, you know, away from our village, we go to extremely remote spots, it's safer. We have built a platform on top of our Land Rover, and we have a tent that pops up at night, and that's better than being on ground level where the critters might get you. Now, that's hands-on ministry. For a few years, they did village ministry in perils often. And then after a few years, they took a more central and strategic role in the Central African Bible College as those African nationals were coming in and they were being mentored and fortified. And his time in the bush helped them relate to, yeah, that's what you do. You go right out there, not in, you know, into those remote spots, and you do what I have shown, you know, and yet Africa will stay with this family for life in many ways. It's in their heart. But let me say, it's also in their body. Paul said, I bear the marks of Christ in my body. And the number of times they've been stricken with malaria, and to this day, it will affect their health for the rest of their life. And yet, you know, here's the beauty. We did not choose Christ. He chose us, and he ordained us that we would go and bear fruit and that our fruit would remain. And I want to tell you, when I meet and talk to Jamie and Mandy, I realize God has given them fruit on more than one continent that remains. Currently, Jamie's taking, just recently, he's taken a position as Director of International Baptist Missions Global, and he continues to serve the same Savior. So would you welcome to the pulpit Jamie Smith this morning?
Thank you, Pastor Charles. Well, good morning. It is great to be back with you all. The last time I was here was in April 2019, and so a lot has happened since then, including all of the COVID adaptations, right? Well, it is a joy to be with you today, and I cannot wait to share all that God has been doing, as well as inspire us to be reminded of how he wants to use us right here, right now, to take the gospel all throughout the rest of the world. I wish my whole family were able to be with me today. When you first met them years ago, that boy, who's as tall as me now, was just about 2 years old and running around the nursery here. So a lot has changed in our family. We've got three biological children and one adopted son from Zambia. So obviously my beautiful wife, Mandy, there with the dark curly hair. And it was so funny that all of the biological children, despite like the strength of the darker genes, they all came out looking like me. And so we said, well, Chola as the only one with dark curly hair like you. But Lorelei is now, she's the one right next to me on the end there. She is in her second year at Word of Life Bible Institute. Then Georgia is getting ready to turn 16 and start driving. Warwick just turned 14, and Chola is 12. We love ministering as a family together wherever we are, but as Pastor Charles said, we absolutely loved ministering in Zambia. And yet, the Lord brought us back here for the last 2 years now to be able to lead IBM Global. Why in the world would we see a need to do that? Well, this is the need that we see. A world filled with 7.9 billion people, most of whom would die and go to hell if they were to die today. Many of them because they live in a place where there is no gospel witness, there is no local church. 40% of the world's population still is in a place where they cannot have easy access to the gospel. It's not like here where you can go down the road and see so many churches. This is the need we see, and our vision at IBM Global is to see healthy, multiplying churches led by well-equipped local leaders serving every community around the globe. And that's what led us to come back here from Africa, was so that we could multiply that. The things that we were able to see God do in Africa, we want to see ripple out throughout the rest of the world as we see healthy local churches living out the gospel and communicating it to those around them. Our mission at IBM Global is to serve local churches, just like Elkview Baptist Church, in sending out members as well-equipped missionaries. Now, when we were wrestling through this decision about whether or not to come and step into this role, I always go back to Scripture. What is the pattern that we see from God's Word? And if you look at the life of Paul that's illustrated here on this chart, we see four missionary journeys, because I count his imprisonment in Rome as his fourth journey. And what do you find? You find a pattern that I think we still see today, and it certainly has been true of our life. So you begin with smaller distances, smaller costs, and typically you're the practitioner of missions. You're the one taking the gospel out around the world to those who've never heard. And then as you continue, you then not only continue doing that yourself, but training the next generation. And that's what we see with Paul. Missionary journey number one, he was a practitioner of missions. Missionary journey number two is whenever you see him bring onto the team Timothy and Titus, two individuals that were first led to the Lord in missionary journey number one. This is where you see Paul then reflect that same message and pass on that same charge to Timothy later from Rome when he writes 2 Timothy 2:2. The things that you've heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, you now entrust to faithful men who are able to teach others also. This is the pattern. Paul lived it out and then he taught it so that it would be carried on. Third missionary journey. The distance increased, the number of days, the cost, well, so did the responsibility. He's still practicing, he's still sharing the gospel, making disciples, establishing churches, and he's still training people, but he's also doing a lot of administration because as the team grows, he's able to send different team members out to different locations so that they have a multiplication of efforts in a variety of cities so that the gospel continues to ripple out. Well, that's exactly how our ministry in missions has been carried out as well. Missionary journey number one to the villages in Nambaza, Zambia, where we shared the gospel and saw two churches planted. Missionary journey number two, we went from the village of Nambaza to the city of Kitwe to establish the missions training program at Central Africa Baptist University. And yet at the same time, we continued planting churches there. We planted two churches in that area, Kitwe Church and Chingola Church. Then practitioner, trainer, and administrator, the team grew. Graduates were joining the team and being sent out around the world. And then lately, what we found is this last stage, our fourth term, mirrors that of Paul. Now, Paul's was an imprisonment. Thankfully, mine is not that. But it did involve mostly administration because a growing team needed a leader. And that's what I have the privilege of getting to do now. And as we think about this, I know sometimes you hear about missionaries who've served overseas and then they come back to the States, and sometimes you're tempted to say, oh, they came home. Nothing could be further from the truth because this isn't home to us. Although Africa is not home to us either. The more you do missions work, the more you realize the truth of Scripture that this world is not our home. We are just passing through. But while we're here, we want to make every moment count. So why is it that we came back? It's to facilitate gospel advance to the least reached. And we have the privilege of being able to do that because of ministry partners like you, who have been with us all the way since 2012. For 10 years, we've partnered in spreading the gospel around the world, and God has blessed it greatly. And we're so thankful for that. We're so thankful for you. Now, as we continue forward, we want to continue seeing this team grow. IBM Global, we aspire to be the mission agency of choice for spiritually healthy, forward-thinking, strategically positioned, courageous servants of Christ. And that's exactly what we're seeing God do. I know everywhere I go, people ask, so how are things going, you know, in that regard? Well, God's doing awesome things. We now serve 36 local churches and sending out members as missionaries. And that means we have thousands of supporting churches that are also partners in that. We have 80 active missionaries in 17 nations around the world. And what we do is we provide them with leadership and philosophical direction for ministry, biblical and cultural training, spiritual and emotional encouragement and accountability on the field, because it gets lonely. And times get hard. And when you're in a situation like that, you are tempted in many ways, sometimes ways that would involve changing how you do things so that you feel more effective rather than sticking to the basics and allowing God to produce the fruit. And so we come alongside of the missionaries to help in all of these areas. And of course, the one that everybody knows, we provide the logistical support, financial accounting and things of that nature. So the best way I can describe what a mission agency does is to picture this tree. The whole image is a beautiful picture of the body of Christ, God's church. And we talk about church planting. Well, think of it this way. The roots in this picture are going to illustrate all of the ministry partners on this side of the world who are getting missionaries out to the rest of the world. You're the roots, getting the resources that God provides from here to there. And so the sending church would be the major portion of the trunk underneath the surface, and then you'll have lots of supporting churches and lots of individuals along the way. So what is IBM Global? What is a mission agency? We're the part of the trunk that you see above ground because we are used as the conduit, the pathway of getting those resources from one place to another. And then the missionaries are going to be the branches. And what do we see on that tree? A lot of fruit. The resources that God uses from here get translated into a lot of effort on that side of the world, but only God can give the increase of souls saved, believers matured, and churches established. And that's what we're seeing. Many churches established, composed of new believers. So we are thankful for all the partnership we've had over the years. I do get asked frequently, what are some ways that we can continue partnering? What are some new needs? Well, right now we are trying to lead IBM Global into stages of development and growth without having to increase the administration fee on the missionaries. We are seeking churches and individuals who would actually partner with IBM Global to take them on, to take the organization on for support. And looking for five churches that would take us on at $500 a month or 25 individuals at $100 a month so that we would be able to continue hiring some much needed staff in the office. Also, we want to continue, we have a lot of applicants and we've increased our quality of training for new missionaries. And so we would have a special fund to be able to help offset the costs of the missionary candidate and appointee training. And then lastly for us, ministry here is more expensive than it was for us in Africa. And so right now we're still seeking to raise an additional $1,800 per month to cover the cost of life and ministry on a global scale. So if you want to find out more about IBM Global, you can visit our website. You can actually get out your phone. It scans that, takes you right there, and you can find out all sorts of things about how we can partner together in gospel advance. Well, as we think of all of that, today I am thrilled to be able to come and challenge us from God's word regarding motivation for all Christians to live on mission. Would you open up your Bibles to Matthew chapter 22? Matthew chapter 22. As you're turning there, I'll share a few stories and walk down memory lane a little bit with you. So we did have the privilege of serving in Zambia, whose motto is the real Africa. From 2012 to 2020, we were your missionaries, your ambassadors. This is what we looked like when we first got started. All of those big teenagers you saw, this was them in 2010. That was our very first prayer card. And boy, has God done a lot since then. We often get asked the question, so what was life like in Zambia? Well, it could be described in a lot of ways, but perhaps the one that summarizes it well would be, it was an adventure. A big adventure. How many of you love mudding? My first mudding experience off-road 4x4 was right here in West Virginia. Any fellow mudders out there? Really? We're in Elkview and none? All right, well, I'm sure you can appreciate it anyway, because it was a 4x4 off-roading paradise in Zambia. This road right there is not... This is not a little pathway. That is the main road from the largest mining city in Zambia to Kitwe, Zambia, where the college was. And this was me going out there to preach the gospel. This was to go out there and offer a class to Zambian pastors who needed further training. So we're on our way to Solwezi, and this is what it looked like. We were the only ones that could get through there because of the vehicle that the Lord blessed us with, a Land Rover Defender, and you can see this was what it looked like when we would drive to the village that we lived in for our first 2.5 years of ministry. What you can't tell is there's about 8 inches of water on that dirt path. It was raining, took down 5 trees, had to cut them up just so other people could get by. And this was our everyday life. This was us. We would go for a month at a time to the bush, and then we'd have to go back into town to do our prayer letter, get our money from the bank, turn in reimbursement forms, restock supplies, repair the vehicle, and then head right back out. So that's what it looked like for us to get from the closest civilization to the village where we lived. And only one time did we get stuck, but it was a good stuck all the way down to the frame. Camping, as you heard, it wasn't just a hobby. It was a way of life there. It was pretty interesting. Here is that tent on top of the vehicle that you heard about. And it did come in handy, keeping us away from the cobras at night that like to circle around tents. And they strike at anything. They have very poor vision at night. And so they're looking for rats. And when we were on the ground, you could hear them at night. And I asked what was happening. I asked some of the villagers that lived near us, and they said, be very careful. Don't let your arm get against the side of the tent. That's a cobra, and it will bite you. So this kept us away from those. It kept us at eye level with the elephants when they would come through. It was pretty, pretty amazing. We did outgrow that, and so we cleared some of the land. We did live in that tent with the blue tarp on it. Our shower can be seen next to that tree. I mean, it was an interesting, awesome time. Cooked everything over the fire every day, did all of our laundry by hand, and then the cows would come and rip it off the clothesline while it was drying. So eventually, we ended up building a structure that could have a thicker canvas tent, and we put a cement pad down to keep the cobras and all of those types of things away. And when it was all said and done, it looked like that. And the reason we did it this way was those are all local materials. We made the bricks ourselves right out there. We used all of the local wood that was termite resistant and the local grass. So that way when we worked ourselves out of a job and were no longer there, the people who continued to carry on the ministry knew how to also take care of the building. It wasn't a Western-style building that they didn't know how to deal with. It was all made from local materials that they could use and maintain. What else was life like? Well, wildlife safari, just on our drive to town. Zebra frolicking and fighting out in the fields. A lechwe, we'd have lots of impala, but the lechwe were gorgeous, and they were rare. It was very hard to spot them, but we would have those. Eland and elephant, that's right. We would have sometimes up to 300 elephant come through migrating at night right past our tent. And they're big. And they're not friendly. They're not circus elephants. And so you can see how close they would get as Warwick's there in front of the Land Rover and the elephant right in front. And of course, our least favorite of the wildlife, the spitting cobra that our dogs killed before it could get in, and the scorpion that stung Lorelei. Now, it was an adventure, but that's not why we went to Africa. We went because we had the great honor of obeying the Great Commission to make disciples of all nations. And the word nations is ethne, all ethnic groups, all peoples. Where we were at, they had never heard the name of Jesus before. There was no competing religion other than traditional African religion, witchcraft. So we went to make Jesus famous by telling his story. Because that's how you make a person famous. You tell their story. And boy, does Jesus have the best story the world could ever know. Our vision for the ministry in Africa was to facilitate obedience to the Great Commission until every village, town, and city across Africa had been reached through the presence of a gospel-centered local church. Well, God used our time there to be able to produce quite the movement of churches that have carried on the work since then. We had the privilege of planting two in the bush. Those two have planted three more. Those five are in the process of planting two more again. In town, the same thing was true. Kitwe Church started Chingola Church, and then Chingola and Kitwe Church. We've now sent out missionaries up to Uganda and up to Darfur, Sudan. It's rippling out across Africa. We went to take the gospel to sinners in need of a savior, many of them having never heard the good news of salvation of sin ever. We went to help Christians grow, then gather into churches, train them to tell others about Jesus, and help them grow as Christians. The cycle that would repeat. And this is what it looked like. These were the churches out in the village of Nambaza. Kauka Baptist Church and Kakuse Baptist Church. Those were the first two. Then this was Charter Sunday in Kitwe, the second largest city. Very different appearance, right? Lots of different. There are seven different countries represented in that one picture. This was it on an average Sunday, and you can just see the diversity because these were the people that nobody was reaching. Eventually, we ended up moving into an old movie theater, and that's where they have already met today as they continue to worship the Lord and spread the gospel throughout the continent. It truly is amazing to see all that the Lord did. This was the day that the church that we planted, Kitwe Church, sent us off to now go plant Chingola Church. And this was Chingola Church the Sunday before we came back here to lead IBM Global. And we continue to see God doing great things through Central Africa Baptist University as we now have over 200 graduates serving in ministry around the world. What an amazing thing to see what God can do through ordinary people. So that takes us back to the question, what is our motive for gospel advance? The motivation for all Christians to live on mission. I often get asked the question, why would someone want to move to another culture to be a missionary? And the answer is, it's the same reason that each of us should live on mission in our everyday lives, in our own culture, and God-appointed jobs. Your job is just as special as any missionary's job. God strategically placed you there. So, what is our motive? It's to please God, the one who enlisted us, the one who called us to service, because he's the one who saved us from our sin. Let's read Matthew chapter 22. Let's actually start in verse 34, because it gives us the background of what Jesus is encountering this day. It says, but when the Pharisees heard that he had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together. Then one of them, a lawyer, asked him a question, testing him and saying, teacher, which is the great commandment in the law? Jesus said to him, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. As we see this, I am always amazed at how Jesus would take complex things and make them simple. This lawyer thought he was going to be tripping Jesus up by asking him a question. Out of all of Scripture, out of all of the Old Testament, that much, what's the greatest commandment? That seems like a trick question, right? There's so much in there. But it didn't stumble Jesus one bit. In fact, it gave him a wonderful teaching opportunity. He took the complex and he made it simple. You see, in the Old Testament, all the law and the prophets, there are 633 commands that flow, those 633 flowed out of the Ten Commandments. And Jesus says, I can make it simpler than that. We can reduce it down to just two. Love the Lord your God with everything you are, and then love your neighbor as yourself. That's really what it comes down to. And the key word in both of those is love. Love is the basis for living on mission. Love is the basis for going out of your comfort zone and sharing the gospel. You see, selfish people don't evangelize because it means stepping out of your comfort zone. What's the thing that causes you to do it? What's the thing that causes you to live on mission? Love, first of all for God, And secondly, for those that God loves, his creation, mankind created in his image. And it's so very important that we keep these two reasons in the right order. It has to start with God, not with man. You can love people and you can give to them, but eventually your love will be challenged, it will be fatigued, and you'll burn out. One of my college professors made a huge impact on my life with this statement. He said, "A love for people may take you to the mission field, but only a love for Jesus will keep you there." So true right here, isn't it? You can go out and share the gospel with people right here in your neighborhoods and at your workplaces, and you genuinely do it for love, but sometimes people make it hard for you to love them. Why? Because they're convicted over their sin, they recognize their guilt, but they don't want to acknowledge it. They don't want to repent of it. They would have to agree with God that they are wrong. And mankind's greatest inclination is to proclaim their own goodness. A big opposition to repentance is this innate need that we have to create and keep a good record and reputation. The thing is, we can't do it, but we try. And so in people's desire to proclaim their own goodness, as you're sharing the love of God with them, they push you away because it's easier to make you avoid them so that they can now not have to avoid confrontation over their sin as they're confronted with the love of God. The very thing they need, they reject. Why? Because it requires humility to fully accept. So let's talk a little about this first idea, love for Jesus. Loving God with all your heart, soul, and mind. Well, Jesus is God the Son. Loving Jesus is living out the great commandment. Why should we love God? We're told here in this passage that we should, right? Matthew 22, it just tells us this is what you should do. But people have a hard time doing the things they're told to do unless they understand the reason why. Why should we love God? Well, Jesus makes it really clear. I want you to think back to the time before you decided to follow Jesus. And I don't know everyone here, so some of you might still not know Jesus as your personal Savior. Maybe you're coming here as a visitor today. Maybe you've grown up in this church your whole life, but you've never put your faith in Jesus. You're trying to decide, can I really trust him to be the Lord of my life? Because maybe I won't get to do the things I want to do. Maybe you're wrestling through, is this true or not true? Because the world says all sorts of things that they think we're believing a myth. I don't know what your spiritual condition is here today. Maybe you're still wrestling through this. Maybe this topic we're about to delve into is exactly what you need to be thinking through. But for those who've already put their faith in Jesus, I want you to think back to the time before you had done that. What was it that drew you to him? What did God use to bring you to faith? What motivated you to become a Christian? Now, maybe you're an intellectual type and you had to go through a lot of these studies of the defense of the faith, you know, apologetics as it's known. But you know what? That's not what won you. That might have helped remove obstacles. But what was it that won all of us? The love of God, isn't it? The love of God. The songs this morning were, man, they were amazing. They grabbed my heart. They moved me to tears as I knew what I would be sharing with you today. We sang the song, "His Love Endures Forever." Why should we love God? Because he first loved us. 1 John 4:19 makes it so clear. We love him because he first loved us. Isn't that true? And that's the motivation that we have for now living on mission. The love of God that gripped our own souls. Are you gripped by grace today, the same that you were when you first came to know Jesus? Or has it kind of cooled off? Has your love waned? Are we guilty of what Jesus speaks in Revelation 2, having left our first love? Well, we should love Jesus because he first loved us. His love grips our heart. It breaks down our resistance to admit our guilt. His love compels us to turn in repentance with a change of mind about my real spiritual condition. To change of heart, of what I love, and a change of actions, how I spend my time. Reminds me of a story from Zambia that we lived through. I call it the woman, the witch doctor, and the water. To get to where we lived in the rainy season, you had to drive through a place that normally was dry, but now it's got a flowing current. It's a river. Here's a 10-second journey. This was our Land Rover, which was elevated. It sat high, and you can see it's coming up over that. Well, this is our journey out to the village. While there, this was, by the way, within our first 2 months in Zambia. And while there, this woman comes up to me and says, Pastor Smith, my children are sick. There's no way for me to get them to the closest hospital. It's all the way back where you live, 5.5 hours by car. 100 miles, 5.5 hours. That'll let you know the road conditions. And that was before the rainy season. And she said, can I get a ride with you to get there? And I said, oh, absolutely, we'll take you there. But you have to also know we're going to be crossing a river. And Zambians are terrified of water. They can't swim. I said, are you okay with that? Do you trust me? And do you trust God to get you there? Oh, yes. So the next day, it rains. And the water went up even higher than that. And we are loading up the vehicle. And as we're loading it up, I noticed that there's a strange object ready to be packed. It's a glass jar filled with chicken bones and kind of yellowish fluid. It's cow urine. This was the magic charm from the witch doctor. In her worldview, she knows that there's all sorts of dangers out there and everything has a spiritual cause. She's not trying to do anything wrong. She just knows that there's a danger out there and she's actually trying to help the whole group. The only way that she knows how, she goes to the witch doctor and says, can I buy some strong magic from you to keep us safe on our journey? She had to pay good money for this. So she buys it, she brings it. This is a gift of love on her part, right? And it's also for her own protection. And I looked at that and I said to one of the pastors that was with me, is that what I think it is? And he said, oh, yeah. And I said, okay, well, this is a teachable moment. So I called the village elder over, who was the first believer in that village. And I said, Mr. Mobola, I cannot take this. The very thing she's hoping it will do, provide protection, is the very opposite thing it will do. We're bringing evil into this vehicle, and we're more likely to have a problem that way. This isn't superstition. There is power in witchcraft. And so we called her over, and we had to do it very respectfully. You can't do it the way that so many people in the previous era of missions would do it, of condemning them and how dare you do this, don't you know? No, that's the point. She doesn't know that this is against God's will. She doesn't know that she's appealing to evil spirits to bring about a good result. And so we shared this with her, and I said, I want to take you there, but I cannot take that. And you have a choice to make. You can either put your trust in that and not go, or you can put your trust in my God who will keep us safe. Are you willing to leave it behind? And she said, oh, okay. So we get in the vehicle, we get to that stream, and I see that it's deeper. And now I'm thinking, okay, Lord, I just said that we can all trust you. Please let us get across this stream. And we go down in there, and I mean, it's deeper than the day before. And, you know, as you're pushing through it, the water, it creates a wave. So as I look behind me, I hear her go, she's holding her breath because the water is now coming up over her window. She's looking out to water. And we get to the other side, and it's struggling to climb out. It's all slippery mud on top of rock, and we're going all sideways, and finally it grabs a little bit of traction. We come up out of the bank like this. The front two tires are off the ground, and boom! And and she starts cheering in the Zambian way. She's happy as can be. And I said, you see, you can trust our God to protect us, and he can protect you from more than just water. That was in January. The waters did cut us off from getting back out there until the dry season. So now it's April. When I had been out there the previous October, November, people were looking on with suspicion. What is this new religion? What is this belief? I show up that first day, and the whole village is waiting for me. And they said, we heard what you did for Mrs. Malimbwa. We have all come to find out about the God who can keep her safe. And she says that you say he can keep us safe, not just from the water, but from the evil spirits, and can give us eternal life. Tell us more. All those pictures that you saw of those churches can be traced to that day. The day that God revealed his power and his love. Yep, we can trust God. We should love God because he first loved us. And by the way, he died to prove that love. God demonstrates his own love toward us in this, that while we're still sinners, Christ died for us. Romans 5:8. John 15:13. Greater love has no one than this, than that he would lay down his life for his friends. That's the message that won Joseph Mwambazi to the Lord. He grew up in that village of Nambaza. He had been looking for truth. He'd gone out to another village where he heard Seventh-day Adventist beliefs, which is really like the early church with the Judaizers, living for the Lord by works and thinking that works were going to get your salvation. And he recognized the truth that Jesus died on the cross, and that's all that we need to be able to be saved. It's not faith plus works, it's faith alone in Christ alone. Why should we love God? Because he took our punishment and gave us a present. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. These are the reasons that we should love the Lord our God with all our heart, soul, and mind. Let me ask you, have you accepted God's gift? Before you can truly love God, you must first accept his love for you and let it change you. If you haven't done that, I pray that today would be the day you put your faith in him. So we're told here, love the Lord your God. We've seen why, but now how? How do we show our love for God? We obey him. John 14, verse 15, if you love me, keep my commandments. John 15, verse 10, if you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. This is how we demonstrate our love for the Lord, obedience. Now let me ask you this. Out of all the commandments that we find in the Bible, not just the Old Testament, the whole Bible, what commandment best reflects both parts, both of these two commands that we see in Matthew 22? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. What commandment allows us to accomplish obedience to both of those in one action? It's the Great Commission. The Great Commission is what allows us to love both God and man this way at the same time. In Mark 16, verses 15 and 16, it says, he said to them, Jesus said, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He who believes and is baptized will be saved, but he who does not believe will be condemned. Condemned. That's the situation that all mankind find themselves in by default because of our sin. So we need to share the gospel with him. Love the Lord your God. Share his story to make him famous. Why? Because that's how we also show love to our neighbor. How do we love them? By being witnesses of Christ's love and power. His power to forgive sin and make us right with God. In Luke 24, we see the gospel message in the Great Commission, because this is one of the passages that we refer to as the Great Commission. Thus it is written, and thus it was necessary for the Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead the third day, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. And you are all witnesses of these things. Makes me think of the song we sang this morning. Oh, praise the name. He shall return. That was part of the song that we sang. The question is, are people around us ready for that? Or will they be in a Christless eternity? I think we know the answer for many of them is a Christless eternity. They might be religious, but they're lost. Does that move you? If it doesn't move you, then you don't love your neighbor as yourself. And you're not obeying the first and second greatest commandments. It should move us. It moved this couple, the Jumas, to go to one of the most dangerous places on earth in Africa, under persecution from Islam, and they're planting a church there. In fact, they've already had their first baptismal service, 6 believers. They've only been on the field 9 months. God's at work. Why? Because they love their neighbor enough to go and put their own life at risk to share the gospel. How do we love our neighbor? By being witnesses, by inviting people to join the family of God, by being adopted. That's what we see in Galatians 4. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law. Why? To redeem those who were under the law, all of us, that we might receive the adoption as sons. And because you are sons, God has sent forth the spirit of his son into your hearts, crying out, Abba, Father. We got to experience that when we adopted Chola. And one of the reasons that we adopted him was to live out the gospel right there in Zambia, to be a living demonstration of what God does for each sinner who repents of their sin. He adopts them as a son or daughter. And when we would go into town and we would go into the market, it was a living representation of the power of the gospel. We need to invite people to be adopted into God's family. We need to invite people to have a restored relationship with God. 2 Corinthians 5:20, now then we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were pleading through us. Have you pleaded with somebody to return to God, to repent from their sins? Because that's what we're supposed to do. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. If you have accepted God's love, are you now demonstrating your love for him by sharing his love with others like you're commanded to do? I think for so many of us, we struggle with that. And it's easy to hear a story from Africa like the woman, the witch doctor in the water, and go, yeah, those people need that. Just look around right here. Look at the drug epidemic in West Virginia. The struggles might take on different forms, but the heart issue behind all the struggles is still the same. They're alienated from the God who created, and they're always going to be looking for something to satisfy them. But the only thing that will ever satisfy a soul is to be reunited with the God that created them to have a relationship with him. Yeah, we had the privilege of doing that in Africa. You have the privilege of doing it right here. Living on mission is a great honor. Do you recognize that the mandate given to you is actually a tremendous privilege and honor rather than a burden or sacrifice? Do you? David Livingstone, missionary to Africa, said, if a commission by an earthly king is considered an honor, how can a commission by a heavenly king be considered a sacrifice? But isn't that how often we view it? Well, I can't share the gospel. I might lose my job. I might not be included with these. I want to still be accepted within my social circles. That's no reason to not share the gospel. Yes, living on mission is a great honor. Partnering with a missionary is also a great honor. Could there be any better way to spend your time and money than to advance the gospel to the ends of the earth? Being a missionary is a great honor. Could it be that right here in this congregation today, there is somebody that God is preparing and equipping and calling to go overseas to the least reached? Could it be that God wants you to have this same honor of going out as his ambassador around the world? God delights in using ordinary people to accomplish the extraordinary. He did it with David. That's what we see in Psalm 78. Took him from being a shepherd to a king, and he still does it today. He took me from a farm and put me around the world, and now allows me to minister all around the world through IBM Global. Reminds me of the song just before the message. Were it not for grace, I can't tell you where I'd be. Wandering down some pointless road, my salvation up to me. Sometimes I think people are hesitant to serve God in this way because they think, how could God use somebody as small as me, as weak as me? But that's the whole point. God delights in using the ordinary to accomplish the extraordinary so that all the glory goes to him. Are you willing to consider surrendering your life in any way that the Lord would deem fit? How could God use the things that you like to do, your hobbies, your interests, in order to help people in other parts of the world hear the gospel for the first time? Well, we've run a marathon together today. We've looked at the motivation for all Christians to live on mission. The single greatest way to make your life matter is to know the God who made you. Do you know him? The second greatest way to make your life matter is to share the gospel that changed your life with others who need the same gift that you've received. Will you do that today? Father, I pray that as we've looked at your word, we've been encouraged, we've been challenged, and that we will not leave here the same as when we entered, but rather you would cause us to take action, that you would have stirred our hearts in order to strengthen our wills and to use the gifts that you've given us to now take your message out to the lives of others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I would like to just ask us to ponder, you know, didn't that story, the woman, the witch doctor, and the water, wasn't that insightful? Now, God sent a witness. How many of you understand the Father's love for others a little bit better today by understanding where he goes with the gospel, where the Father goes? Did that speak to your heart? Our Father loves others. He loves us. And that love is the basis to us living on point. And that lady over there in Zambia, she got it. She understood it. The love of God reached her. All right. The brother that's in Darfur, Sudan, I hope I'm saying that right. He just got up there. He's already had baptisms. It is his love that he's understood how much he's loved by the Father that is sustaining him. Now, as I close in prayer, this is what Pastor Charles has taken away from the message today. One of the things, I'm reading from Ephesians 3:18, and I'm reading a paraphrase this morning. I'm praying for the church that you would have the power to understand, as all God's people should understand, how wide and how long and how high and how deep the Father's love is. May you experience the love of Christ that is too great to fully understand, because it will make you complete. Well, would we bow our heads? And I would just ask you, take a moment of silent prayer. Are you loving God supremely? And are you serving others selflessly? That's the proper expression of really being in love with the Father, is our obedience to serve. Just take a moment to pray. And our Father, thank you for such graphic illustrations that you love the dear brothers and sisters in Zambia just as much as you love me. And you've placed a witness there, and there's a network of churches expanding there even today. And people's sin issues are being melted away, and the presence and the power of the gospel is prevailing. And I thank you that your love can grip us so deeply that it motivates us to act like you would act and to love other people selflessly. And the Great Commission is in doing that. Mission together is how we express our love for you and love for others in the same command. Thank you. Thank you for our commitment to missions. Thank you for the new missionaries we've taken on this year, the ones we're budgeting to take on next year. But Father, help us do even exceedingly more than what we might budget. Move our hearts to become excited for just expressing your love all around the world. We love you and thank you for everyone's presence this morning. In Jesus' name. As we're dismissed today, If we've left you with a spiritual question or burden on your heart, would you make a point to stop by and see me in the lobby? I'd like to be able to help with that. Jamie, if you don't mind, would you head on out? And as he hits that door, you're going to be dismissed to lunch. Okay? Have a great day. God bless you. We'll see you Wednesday.